is Morning Air, your home for faith, fun, and news in the morning.
Get connected to the conversation. 888-914-9149. And welcome back to Morning Air. I'm John Morales, along with Glenn and Sarah behind the glass. Thanks so much for tuning in. It's good to be with you on this Monday morning here on Relevant Radio and the Relevant Radio app. You can email us directly. It's morningair@relevantradio.com. And our number, if you want to be part of the program, 888-914-9149, 888-914-9149. Now, as we spoke about last week and reported on the former leader of Hamas, Khaled Mashal, called for a global day of jihad, with protests erupting across the Muslim world this past Friday, October the 13th, in support of the Palestinians and for the peoples of neighboring countries to join the fight against Israel. We saw large anti-Israel rallies by pro-Palestinian supporters in numerous American cities, including New York City, and more than a dozen countries around the world. There were also many protests across U.S. college campuses last week after the Hamas attacks, from Harvard all the way to UCLA and many in between. Listen to these UMass Jewish college students denounce anti-Israel protests as heard on Fox News.
Right now, I do not feel safe on campus. I'm still a proud Jew. I wear my Star of David every day. I am proud. I am proud of my heritage.
I don't feel safe on campus right now. A lot of my friends are in the IDF. A lot of my family is in Israel. My cousins are there right now. So many of my friends. I'm just so worried for the safety of my people, for my friends there, and I feel like I should be there fighting right now.
A bunch of brainwashed individuals who just don't have no idea what's going on right now in Israel, both in Palestine, and they're just misinformed. They don't understand the terror that Hamas is causing to the Israeli citizens.
I find this protest incredibly, incredibly disrespectful to the loss of life, thousands of Jews dead, the most amount of Jews dead since the Holocaust. People who don't think this is the second Holocaust are ignorant and they need to educate themselves. This whole thing, they are supporting a terrorist organization. They are not supporting Palestinians who want peace with Israel. They are supporting a deep-rooted hate of Jews.
And joining us live this morning for much more perspective is Roy Shoman, a Jewish entrant into the Catholic Church, for a theological and historical perspective on Muslim hostility towards Israel. Roy Shoman writes, speaks, and teaches broadly on the theological and historical relationship between Judaism and the Catholic Church. He has taught at Holy Apostles College and Seminary and at Ave Maria University as an adjunct professor. Roy Shoman is also the author of Salvation is from the Jews and Honey from the Rock. Good morning, Roy. Thank you so much for joining us here on Morning Air and Relevant Radio. It is good to be with you.
Well, thanks for inviting me. It's good to be here.
Professor, I'd love to get your reaction to what happened this past Friday, October the 13th, which ironically was also the anniversary, the 106th anniversary of the miracle of the sun at Fatima.
Yeah. I think it's very telling, actually, because what you said, okay, there's like a fork in the road of understanding this. And one is to see that the underlying problem is one of geographic territory and of the self-determination of the, you know, Arabs in the territory of Palestine versus the Jewish state and so forth, and to see it as a kind of a political slash geographical problem. But what you saw on Friday is it isn't. It's really a theological problem. And the problem is that as we as Christians have the Great Commission to go out and make disciples of the whole world, Islam has the Great Commission to go out and subject the whole world to Islam by the sword if necessary. And so what you see bubbling through the surface in Israel is actually the theological imperative of Islam, particularly intensely because Israel is geographically in the center of the Islamic world, the Muslim world, and so it's particularly a thorn in their side.
Professor, what went through your mind when you heard the voices of these young college students and their reaction to so much really anti-Israel rhetoric?
What was my reaction? I don't know how to answer that. I mean, I'm sympathetic for them. I mean, it's a horrible situation for them to be in. The shouting in the background, which I assume was the pro-Hamas demonstrators, must have been a very uncomfortable experience for them.
No doubt about it. And this went on in many college campuses across the country, not to mention all the other demonstrations last Friday in Times Square, New York, and in other cities around the world. Roy, did you ever imagine you would see a day in which another 9/11 type situation would happen in Israel, the largest loss of Jewish life since the Holocaust?
Yes, yes, yes. Israel has the existence of Israel has always hung by a rather slender thread, and it came very close to being wiped out in 67. It came very close to being wiped out in 73. The determination to wipe out Israel has been a constant since 1947, as the Arab world gets stronger, as a matter of fact, the worldwide influence of Islam gets stronger, as technology advances and destruction can take place on larger and larger scale. Yeah, no, I think it's a ticking time bomb. So it's not a surprise.
Professor Roy, why do you think that there is such hatred in so many different places for the Jewish people? For me, as a cradle Catholic, it's so hard to understand, especially when you consider that our faith has such strong roots in the Jewish people.
Well, there's a very particular situation with Islam, among others being that Muhammad, according to Islam, was assassinated by a Jewish woman. And in the life of Muhammad, his number one enemies by far were the Jewish tribes. And there are many accounts in the Quran of very personal animosity. For instance, kill any Jew who comes into your power is a quote from Muhammad. So it's very deeply rooted. I mean, you can't get it out of Islam. You can't get it. I mean, this is the Quran. You can't whitewash it. It's the foundation of their belief system, and Jews are the enemies of God in the Quran, and Jews are the enemies of Muhammad. So, what choice do they have in a sense?
Obviously, Pope Francis, the Holy Father, is praying for peace, but at the same time, he acknowledged that Israel had defend themselves. They have a right to defend themselves, is what I'm trying to say.
They have no choice. Otherwise, it's suicide. I mean, it's literal suicide. It's not just the loss of the nation, but it's the death of all of the Jews in Israel if they don't defend themselves. That's really the only desired end game. The end game from the Palestinians has never been a two-state solution with a separate state. They were offered that in 1947. That was the very beginning of this problem, was that the UN divided Palestine into a Jewish section and a Arab section. And the Jews accepted the limitations of only having a small piece of Palestine, and the Arabs didn't. And the next day they launched war.
How concerned are you on what's going on college campuses? It seems like a lot of people have been brainwashed into believing in ideology and in accepting some of this anti-Semite rhetoric.
Well, it would be interesting to know how much of that would be going on in college campuses if it weren't for the Muslim student associations and the Muslim students. I mean, I don't know. It would be interesting to see in these demonstrations what the ratio is of, American-born or non-Muslim students with the Muslim students and the the immigrants from the Arab world, because that is clearly a significant part of the population. And I think that, you know, I don't know how to put it, but, you know, students go with the current fashion, and the Muslim student associations have done a good job of establishing a kind of, you know, local worldview that says that, you know, they're the victims and they're the peace lovers and all the problem comes from the Jews.
Now, Professor, from a Catholic perspective, of course, our Blessed Mother Mary, our Lord Jesus, and the apostles were all Jews. Can you talk about that relationship between Judaism and our Catholic Church?
I think in some ways a very simple relationship, which is that Judaism is essentially it's essentially the Catholic Church before the coming of the Messiah, and the Catholic Church is essentially post-Messianic Judaism. That is one and the same plan for salvation that God came up with already in the Garden of Eden, and that plan for salvation revolved around the incarnation of the second person of the Most Holy Trinity as a man, and the world had to be prepared for that incarnation, and that preparation was Judaism, with the intention always being that once the incarnation took place and the life of Jesus unfolded, the original, somewhat privileged relationship between God and man, which God had given to the Jews to enable the incarnation, would be extended to all of mankind through the sacraments of the Catholic Church and faith in Jesus.
We're joined this morning by Roy Shulman, a Jewish entrant into the Catholic Church. He's an author, a speaker, and a teacher, and we've been talking about some of the theological and historical backdrop of the Muslim hostility towards Jews and Israel. Professor, you converted from Judaism to Catholicism. Can you briefly share with us how this happened?
Sure. I was a atheist Jewish Harvard Business School professor at the time, about in my late 20s, early 30s, and I didn't believe in God anymore, and I was just kind of a yuppie, and I was in despair at the meaninglessness of life, and I was walking in nature one morning, and I received the signal privilege of a experience in which the veil between the spiritual world and the physical world disappeared, and I found myself in the presence of God, and I understood my life and saw my life as I would see it after dying, looking back over my life in the presence of God. And I saw how I would feel about everything. I saw basically a lot of truths that I now know are truths of the Catholic faith, but I didn't know that at the time. I knew nothing about Catholicism, really. But I saw that we lived forever. I saw that every action had a moral content that was recorded for all eternity. I saw that we would be rewarded for all eternity for everything we did that was of value in the eyes of heaven. I saw that everything that had ever happened in my life had been the most perfect thing that could be arranged, coming from the hands of this all-knowing, all-loving God, not only including the things that caused the most suffering, but especially the things that caused the most suffering, and so forth and so on. So after this experience, I was a religious fanatic. I didn't know what religion it was, but then about a year later, I had a, while I was asleep, I had a very waking feeling, direct experience of the Blessed Virgin Mary. She appeared to me, she offered to answer any questions I might have. I asked her 5 or 6 or 7 questions, which she graciously answered. And the next morning when I woke up, I of course realized that it had been Christ in that first experience. And I wanted to follow him as closely as I could. And because I knew who the Blessed Virgin Mary was, and I had an experience of her, that that made me aim pretty directly towards the Catholic Church.
It had to be absolutely awesome to come to the realization that our Blessed Mother is also our Jewish mother, and Jesus is the Jewish Messiah, the fulfillment of everything in the Old Testament.
Yeah, but actually the truth is, if you don't believe in God and you think that you're just a chemical accident and there's no pattern or meaning to anything, that's even bigger. That's even bigger. I was blown away by the fact that everything that as a child I hoped existed and then later decided it was a fantasy was true 100 times, 1,000 times over. That was really, really, really big. I mean, the difference between living forever and living for 80 years, the difference between things just happening with no meaning or pattern, whereas everything is perfectly designed, that's pretty big too.
And I imagine when you
come
to the realization that the Holy Eucharist is the Passover fulfilled, that really kind of had to be able to put it all into perspective.
Oh, it was beautiful to find. I mean, Judaism made sense for the first time in my life, essentially. Judaism, without understanding the relationship, with Jesus to Judaism, doesn't quite make sense. I mean, the Jews, growing up, I always knew we were the chosen people, was always told we were the chosen people. But what's that mean? You know, chosen for what? What's the role supposed to be in the world? Now I know it was to bring salvation to all of mankind through the incarnation of God as man. You know, everything in Judaism actually makes sense and is fleshed out by the truth as it is reflected by the Catholic faith.
Professor, you mentioned that the situation that's going on in the Holy Land is a theological problem, but obviously with a spiritual dimension. Your final thoughts?
Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Blessed are those who pray for the peace of Jerusalem. I think that's Psalm 122. It's a supernatural problem, and if there's a solution, it'll be a supernatural solution.
Professor Roy Shulman, thank you so much. Really appreciate you being with us here on Morning Air and Relevant Radio.
Thanks a lot, and thanks for all that you do to spread the gospel.
Many blessings to you. And again, the website is salvationfromthejews.com.
Salvation is from the Jews. Is from the Jews. Okay, thanks.
Roy Shulman, a Jewish convert into the Catholic Church, the author of Salvation is from...
Hey, Roy, that was great. Thanks so much for being on the show. We appreciate it.
Thanks a lot. Good luck.
Okay, have a good one.
God bless. Bye.
Bye.
And speaker, Matt Barafato, the author...